Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
91.3 Capital FM, Desert Island Discs series on this wonderful Sunday evening. And as always, sharing with you life's incredible stories by folks that have distinguished themselves in more ways than one. Today, we're going to be looking at the life story of a mentor genius. And when I say mentor genius, I mean it literally. Someone that has excelled through school, someone that is trying to excel in what they do, but most importantly, trying to drag along so many geniuses out there that do not know the genius in them and try to put them together and see how best they can harness their potential, if for nothing else, to have creations that are indigenous for our indigenous challenges. Now, I may be sounding like I'm speaking in parables or metaphors, but when we get down to the conversation of the life story of architect Dr. Kenneth Ssemwogerere on the program this evening, you'll understand what I mean. Good evening. Welcome to the program, Doctor.
Good evening.
How are you? How are you keeping?
We're fine. COVID has been with us for a while. Now we're used.
Well, but we are not far from, we are not safe at all. So we need to bear that in mind.
Exactly.
And that's why I guess there's this distance between you and I.
Yes.
But I'm glad that you are safe and fine.
Thank you.
You are an architect par excellence. You teach at the university. You run a consulting firm. And right now you are building what you call the SASA Innovation Hub or Village, whatever you call it, whose story you'll be telling us across as we have this conversation. But tell us how everything you're juggling is going for you.
Yeah, I'm quite a very busy person, and I keep time, so that's how I'm able to manage my programs. Mm-hmm. And as you can imagine, being an architect, it takes you to be creative. So every time I have a challenge, I try and be as creative as possible and manage that challenge. So that's the way I can manage my programs and do all the things that you have said I do.
So you create out of the necessity to manage stress, not so much to provide solutions. Or am I
getting it wrong? Yeah, we do solutions, but what I'm saying is that people get stressed because when they hit a snag, they feel it's the end of the world. But not so for an architect.
No,
not I mean, we try and get a way out of every situation. That's who we are. That's architecture.
Well, I came and found you away from the city, several kilometers in this beautiful place that you call your SASA Innovation Village Hub, did you say?
Center. Yes.
What exactly are you doing here?
We are putting up a center on this 5-acre piece of land. We're out of town in Busika because of the need that we figured out that I've been teaching at university for 20 years, 2014, 2004.
You've been teaching at the university for 20 years.
Yes.
You don't look 20 yourself. So, well, you'll be telling us how you managed that teaching.
I began as a part-time lecturer. Mm-hmm. So that gave me some time, you know. But the whole point that came up with this is that the country, Uganda, has a lot of brainy chaps. Mm-hmm. And when we used to do architecture in 1999, we were 10 in my class. And it was a very brand course, you know. You go for architecture, you are up there.
And you are guaranteed of a job as soon as you come to the university.
So there you are. Now we have 50 final year students. And it's very normal now for a guy to finish mechanical engineering, electrical, architecture, and doesn't have a job. Yes. And they go and work with their moms and their dads in their businesses. And the whole point is, why did they have to do all this? But do they stop being brainy? No. They are very brilliant.
So right from a university lecture room or lab with a first class degree in electrical engineering, and the next thing, the Enchuku was selling general merchandise.
Exactly. You better do your homework. You find out that many graduates, wherever they are, and I'll tell you a case in point, because I employ graduates of architecture, and I can't take on four more architects. No. So if you cap, the economy doesn't grow at the same rate with these courses. So you find that there are a chunk of young people that can design but can't get fitted in the economy. So we are going to begin up a center, which we are calling an innovation center, where people don't design buildings, but we do what they call industrial design or product design.
What's that?
Everything we use in life, somebody designs it. You know, just ask me anything, your watch, your cap, your sunglasses, your shoes. And they do that because
the
they're trained.
Which we are on.
Yes, you know, from first principles, They think of how do you use a phone? How do you use that, a bottle? How do you use a cap? So in other words, they work it out and they sketch. So in this place, we'll be taking people from all settings, mm-hmm. young people, people S6 levers, and they bring them here. We teach them how to sketch, how to think, how to innovate. And by doing that, we'll bring them to the place where they can design for manufacture.
I thought that's what you at the university are teaching.
Yeah, we are teaching architecture, and architecture is majorly where you design buildings.
So there's no one teaching how to design every other thing, including a child's toy?
They are teaching. It's under the Bachelor of Fine Art. I mean, they call it Bachelor of Fine Art, but they have a bit of called industrial design. Mm-hmm. But in that bit, it's more of under the big guy, the fine art guy. So they do printing, branding, packaging, industrial design. But because I had a chance to travel to Australia and Canada, I saw how these nations are taking industrial design mm-hmm. to another level. When you hear about industrialized nations, when I was at UTS Australia, the third year students of industrial design were designing the new form of kitchenware. Because kitchens are becoming smaller. So percolators, bammeries, you know. So in a way, they had asked the university students to design them the next generation. They are designing the next health equipment, MRIs, you know. So it's very interesting that we think that we can industrialize mm-hmm. without designers. That's
well,
a paradox.
We have our own designers. When possible, we can get the designs from Nether and just put molds here and produce en masse. Maybe
yeah,
that's
and the there you are. But you see, Africa has an African touch. It has something different about us. You know, and like I told you when I was starting, because these boys are very intelligent, these girls are very intelligent, mm-hmm. just spin him up a little bit and you do you the next shoe and you buy it at a premium price.
And that's what motivated you to start yes. this place. You'll be telling exactly. us more about this, but yes. I think what's more important now is yes. know about you.
Okay.
Dr. Ssemwogerere.
Yes.
Who are you? When okay. were you born? Where were you born? To where okay. were you born? That's what we do on the program.
Okay.
Tell us your life story.
Yeah, I'm born to Mr. and Mrs. Ssemwogerere. Mm-hmm. They're both alive, thank God, and they were both hoteliers. In those days when Uganda Hotels was the place, my dad was a renowned front office manager.
Wow.
Yes. And one time I met one of the managers at Sheraton, and he remembered him. He said, that guy, he was such a great guy that he was training for International Labor Organization.
Because of his interpersonal skills, the way he speaks to
people. He got a chance to train in Austria. Mm-hmm. He went to Vienna in 1972.
Wow.
To do hotel. You know, Vienna and hotels and
yeah,
Austria.
Exactly.
Top notch. So he came back here very polished. My mother, she was a head housekeeper for Imperial Hotel. Then she went to Fairway. You know, housekeeping is more of walk here, the rooms are clean, you know, the guest is happy. So those are the two brothers, the family in which I was born. We are six of us, mm-hmm. and I have some other brothers and sisters. And for me, what is very critical, I saw them work very, very hard.
Are you an only child here in terms of your father and mother, or do you have siblings? And if so,
I do have siblings.
Which position do you hold in that home?
I'm number three.
Number three, so right almost in the middle.
Yes.
Take us back to the homestead in which yes. you were brought up. I'm sure that was the time when commodities were in scarcity, but for people that worked in the hotel industry,
yes. Yes.
such luxuries as margarine were an everyday luxury at home
yeah.
and all that. Just yeah. take us back to how your upbringing was.
Yeah.
The best of
I think I was born in 1975, and that was, you know, days of Amin, you know, I remember. And then we moved to Chebando. Now, Chebando those days was a way not to go there, thieves and people waylay you and, you know. So, but we came to that place. So that was the place where we grew up. And we used to go, and thank you for my parents. They took us to good schools.
Wow.
Yeah, and my heart feels so proud of them that they took us to good schools. I used to go to Buganda Road. Now,
oh
you, know,
God, you know,
we used to walk
know.
There, but it wasn't a big deal. Of course, the lecturer students used to have the big blue bus. I can actually see it with the words Makere. But anyway, from Buganda Road to Makere was just, you know, few kilometers. But we used to walk 4 kilometers, although from Buganda Road to Chebando, every morning and every evening. And for us, we knew nothing about good life. It was more of get home, go and fetch water, wash the things, ground groundnuts. but my kids are, you know, they're just having a nice time. You know, to tell you the truth, I came to take a plane in university.
Now amazing. Your children are taking planes before.
We have done a tour to the US, the UK, to Bangkok, you know, and that's it. And that's what I tell people. Please, even if your parents are very poor, don't be taken down the road and grumble and what. No. Hit the road running. Say, I must pull this off.
On the program, we play our music, Dr. Yes. Ssemwogerere. What will be your first song?
My first song is God, I Look to You. It's a very powerful song. Like, God, I look to you. You are my everything. Give me reason. Give me vision to see the things that you see. Even here, he's seeing something in this place. So I want to know. I want to know what is God seeing? What does he want me to do? How does he want to do it? That's how people do big things. And you wonder, how could a single individual do that?
Incredible. Let's listen to that song when we return. It's more about your life story. It's Desert Island Discs. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. God, I look to you.
Yes, it's Capital FM's Desert Island Discs. My name is Simon Kasyate. My guest, Dr. Architect Kenneth Ssemwogerere.
Yes.
Many people, you know, like to refer to you people as architecture, only for them to know that architecture is the subject that you studied or teach, as opposed to your title. Exactly. Don't you find that a bit queer sometimes?
Yeah, we are trying to revert that.
Ssentoogo, your architecture.
But you let it be, you know, sometimes.
No, but it's important to correct us when you make that mistake.
And then they call us engineers somewhere along the way.
Yeah, even without the registration.
Engineer wangeyaze wano. I mean, and yeah, like, goodness me.
Uganda Road Primary School.
Yes.
Going through the motions of school.
Yes.
Did you have an inclination that possibly you'd end up here where you are as an architect? Or is it something you picked up along the way? Or did you have other dreams altogether?
I wanted to be a farmer.
What?
I wanted to be a farmer.
What was so glamorous about farming then? Yes, I mean, it's not even glamorous today.
It used to give me the impression these guys are very rich.
They have ready food.
But my mathematics was telling me that if you sell all that sack of matoke or bananas, or, you know, you get a lot of money, you know? But along the way, the entire Buganda Road, you know, Buganda Road by that time was really up there, you know.
Oh, yes.
We are rubbing shoulders with the senior people's kids, you know. Uh-huh. And the means time, and Obote time, Obote one, Obote two, you know, it was very interesting. So when it came to Chibuli, I live Buganda Road. I missed Chisubi by, it was a bad time. I got 6 in my PLA.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. So Chisubi top
so
at
5.
So you
couldn't go at St. Mary's College, Chisubi, then you end up in Chibuli. Chibuli
the thing of selling people, I don't know what it means to sell. You know, they sold me to Chibuli.
You're a teacher now. You must know a thing or two about selling.
Yeah, see that? Chibuli was a place to be. And I thank God for Chibuli because at that time, the headmaster, Kawasi, was very diligent. He understood the students. We were not Muslims, but we thought at home. That's where we met the subject called technical drawing.
Uh-huh.
So the technical drawing exercises were such that they give you a plan and you cut a section to show the vertical angle of that plan. So then my interest was, who makes these plans? So that's where the whole story starts from.
You were intrigued so much so that you wanted to be that person that makes the plans.
Yes.
That was a bit of a long shot.
Yes.
Did you have any background in loving fine art?
A little bit.
But not quite the kind that they would say is talented.
Yes.
So again, I still think that was a long shot. How were you able to do all these decisions? How were you able to make that kind of decision without what others would consider to be the basics? Your parents didn't have
you
a hand in this?
My dad tells me that we used to come and visit me, but I was very quick. I used to little wasting of time. You know, they come and see me and we chat a little bit and they used to let me go back and read. You know, so I was that category of people who used to read fairly a lot. So when I used to go back to, when I found out actually I want to be an architect, I researched about it.
Mm-hmm.
I got to know, what does he do? How does he do it? So it intrigued me the more when I knew about what an architect does. So that set the ball rolling and I went for it. Straight up.
So in Kibuli, all the years you were there, you did very little in terms of extracurricular activities. You were trying as hard as possible to attend to that newfound love for architecture as you had
Not exactly. I used to be a house prefect.
Okay.
So I remember, I'll tell you one interesting thing. Because I was house prefect, I was encouraging many people to participate in their the sports activity. You know, the sports day was a big thing. So I tried out the 10,000 meters boys senior, you know?
Yourself?
Yes.
That's 50 laps or 25 laps?
25 laps.
Woo.
And goodness, Simon, it's, just salute those guys.
It's gruesome.
Yeah, at 18 laps, you're cooked, finished, you know? But somehow, because I was the chair, I managed to end the race. I don't know what number I was, I don't remember. But
there must have been a guy that was looping you, like by the 10th lap, he loops you. Yes. Loops you again.
It was
next...
called Omagolo. It's called Omagolo, yeah.
You still remember that?
Yes, yes, super. It was another house, Luangula. I was in Kakungulu, so yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah.
So you go through these motions of school and complete how many years in Kiibudi?
6 years. My O level and my A level.
You must have fallen in love with the place without a doubt.
Yes, and you see, because I became a prefect at some point, I became the house prefect and I became the leader for the Protestant, the Christian church, you know, then. And because the headmaster understood the concept of these are young people, they're exploring. He used to give us that gap, you know. We are not Muslims, but we didn't feel out of place. We feel very comfortable. So then actually in A-level, my brother Andrew joins me in Tibuli.
Mm-hmm.
And so he came as an A-level guy. I was sitting in S3, S4. So it hooked up very well. You know, I had a nice time because I had a big brother there and, you know, yeah.
Wow, that's very interesting.
Yes.
But of course, you also appreciate that the school such as Tibuli also lays quite a lot of emphasis on more of sport and game.
Yes.
Away from politics as an extracurricular activity.
Yes.
Yes, I saw your terrible attempt at athletics. You never tried out something like football, which was more glamorous and gave you a better name.
Simon, in Tibuli, if you were an amateur, you were an amateur. Tibuli was top class. You know, the footballers there, We're
Super League kind
yes,
of people.
Yes, you know, you would watch Villa, KCCA in the evening, almost. Because half of the players were playing in the national team, you know. You know? And so you would watch it. You couldn't even try out. You had to be either there or, you know, not there.
Yeah. Oh, that's quite very interesting.
Yes.
Let's play the next song. When we return, you'll be telling us more of how you get out of Tibuli and what your eyes were focused on.
Okay. My next song will go... God, you're so good to
me. Wait a minute. Not that I have anything to do with your choice of music, but yeah. You don't listen to any secular music?
I do. I'll have one other song, which I do. But one of the things that I want to tell you is that I came to know the Lord in 1991.
Which class were you
in? That was in S4.
What struck you so hard for you to reach your soul Paul moment?
Some guy preached the message about flying from the frying pan into the fire, you know, I remember.
And it resonated also.
Oh, my goodness. It was very clear that that's where people are going if you don't accept the Lord Jesus.
So for you, you were saved from the fear by instilling in you the fear
yes.
of eternal flames.
Yeah. And, you know, it did it very dramatically. You know? So preachers have to do it very well, you know.
But as you grew older and with the benefit of hindsight, didn't you realize that all these were metaphors and not real?
But I read the Bible more and I understood it more.
Uh-huh.
So that helped me a lot.
Let's play your song. When we return, we shall be more about your life story.
Thank you.
Is Desert Island Discs still with us?
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Amazing love that welcomes me. The kindness of mercy that bought with blood.
91.3 Capital FM, Desert Island, this series. And yes, on the program, we have got Dr. Kenneth Ssemwogerere, who is an architect by excellence. He teaches at the university, Makerere University to be very exact. But he also runs a consultancy that does, you know, supervision of huge infrastructure projects. Notable among them is a key mall in Kampala, whose name I'm not going to mention for obvious reasons, until maybe he pays me to do so. But what struck our eye to have him on the program is his vision around what he calls the SASA Innovation Center, where he believes that together with like minds, they can put together a practical setup for incredibly gifted people, boys and girls alike, to come and harness their potential in terms of designing and building for industry from first principles. I hope I got it right.
Yes, you did.
You see, when we go to schools, we study so much. I'm sure you, being what you are today, the school system didn't spare you from teaching you the Ngoni migration, the Rhinelands,
the
Maji-Maji
rebellion,
the Alps.
Yeah.
And yet they could have concentrated on teaching you shapes and figures like trapezia, circles and angles and you know, obtuse and whatever they are. Just before you tell us how you proceed with your education, let me just pick your mind on our education and what it impacts on us. Do you think we actually learn? Do you think there's learning going on?
I don't know. I don't know how to put it, but I think it is too strict. It leaves very little room for creativity.
Now, let me detail that with your life experience.
Yes.
As you're going through your motions of a student in Chibuli, how much of the experience do you think you lacked, now with the benefit of hindsight, that could have made you a better architect today?
First of all those schools that have practical courses or subjects like woodwork, like
technical drawing,
and fine art have a cutting edge. Because, Simon, you may not understand, but the way the brain works, when you set up a certain external atmosphere around it, it complies. I tell my students, the moment you pick a ruler and a square, and then you get a pencil, the brain tells you, now we need to do things which are orderly. You know? Whereas if you throw out everything and you begin sketching, then the brain opens up. So good creativity with that intuitive insight. So the schools, my appeal to our schools is, let's have some more laxity. Open it up a little bit. It is too strict, you know? Put on your badge, you don't ask. Tuck in. But if you went to class without tucking in, what does that mean?
Well, now you can see why I'm all tucked in like a tetracycline capsule, bow tie and everything.
Yeah.
That's how I was trained.
There you are. There you are.
But then, of course, school also has its own disruptions. Chibuli was a single sex, was not a single sex school.
It was.
You're going through adolescence and getting to realize, there are people that look fairer than yourself.
Yeah.
How was that going? How were you thinking that, when you met the Lord, then it shielded you from all these vagaries?
It did. And you see, when we accepted the Lord Jesus, our fellowship in Chibuli was very strong. In other words, our atmosphere, you remember I told you we're in a Muslim school. So we had little chance to do things in a mediocre way. We were very committed to the Lord. We would go for fellowship. That's how even I became a leader in the school for the born-again Christians or for the Anglican church.
That's tremendous.
So that helped me a lot too.
But then you got the university, and the university has its own dynamics.
Exactly, yes.
Freedom, like never seen before.
Yes.
There's no prying eye of teachers. There is no the shackles of parents that keep you on a short leash.
Yeah, but then you remember, even the main CU, there was a main Christian union at university.
Mm-hmm.
So when I went there in 1994, it was at its height, you know? People like Makoko, Samba, Andrew, people at Miracle Center were there. So it was hotter than even Chibuli.
Wow.
So we plugged in and, you know, took off from there.
Went.
Yeah, and actually in my final year, I was the chair for a big, big group, the main CU, in 1999.
That's very interesting.
Yes.
That means it shielded you from so much that I doubt you ever went to a dance club.
No.
Did you ever take any alcohol?
No.
Not even the temptation to?
No, because you see, it is clear in my head for the many years. That's what Simon happens. When you do things for so long, it becomes like the normal. That's why now they're telling us about the new norm, because you thought things would be like this, but then... Yes, that's what happened.
It's very interesting.
Yeah.
But also it must have given you a lot of time, though, also to concentrate on what you had chosen. Were you given the architecture course at university, first attempt?
That's a good question.
Tell me.
And I'll tell you, in Essex, it was very clear that architecture was for particular schools. Our schools in particular had taken 3 years. The last person from Chibuli was in going to fourth year when we were coming to first year.
Wow.
So there was a whole big deal in school of how could you make it there? So we prayed a lot. And I'll tell you one. We made a group of four of us. The S6 leavers then would go and pray and fast. So we made a group of four. We went into four groups. So I remember where me, there's a guy called Iga Michael, is the MP for, you know, the chairperson for medical in the parliament. We had Tamale Augustine and we had Bale Francis, Bale, who's now a professor in economics. So we used to pray together and we cried out to the Lord to give us these courses. Simon, it was not a joke. The architecture used to take 10 people, 10. So each school would strive to get a slot.
At
so
least
that
one.
Year, she really got a slot.
And that, was you.
Yes.
You are a nice student.
My mother couldn't believe reading the 10 people and I was there.
How do you feel for you?
It was awesome. It was such an achievement. I said, yeah. And that's what happened. I'll tell you about it later on. When S6, people at S6, and you're very intelligent, and you fail, that's what this center will be addressing. You're not written off. You're still brilliant. But because of the examination system, those few weeks you did exams didn't go very well.
So you are simply judged as a fish by your ability to
pass an exam,
not to swim.
Yeah, I had done my courses very badly. Architecture, first choice, commerce, second, statistics, third. Had I missed architecture?
You would have possibly missed the second one as well.
Yeah, that's cooked. Yeah.
But well, we thank God that you are in through,
amen.
More like the proverbial, come all through the eye of the needle. Be that as it may, your next song.
Yeah. My next song is actually from Lake Dube.
Lake Dube?
Yes.
Wow. First secular
song. And it's called, When You Stand for the Truth, You Stand Alone. And as people listen to it, please meditate on those words. The issue of when you stand for the truth, in this country, you stand alone.
There's a bit of activism in how you speak and how you carry yourself around. And the fact that you realized there was not so much learning going on at the university and now you've come to create more like a parallel competitive hub. Doesn't that bring you into trouble sometimes with some of the people that you work with?
You know, the point is, because our approach is going to be very different, we're going to have to bring in the craftsmen, the people who have learned on the job, unschooled dropouts, whatever you call them informal sector. You guys up there say this is the informal sector.
Yeah,
relegated, you know? But they are genius. All the beds that you sleep on, I sleep on, most of them, if not imported, they are made by those guys.
And designed by them.
Yeah, so they're going to bring them here, bring the architecture students, we sit together, begin to design, and you're going to see fireworks here. Seriously.
Wow.
Seriously. We're going to have Made in Uganda brand very, very soon.
What do you intend to design here? Anything, everything?
Yeah, we're going to be systematic. First of all, we're going to try and concentrate on those things that were predominantly our thing. Case in point, the port.
Mm.
You know, ported water was just a class apart, isn't it? But ever since then, it didn't have a cap. You know, port was covered by either a source or pan or whatever. Up to today,
no one has designed a lid.
Because you went ahead and used fridges, but you can't compare fridge water
to sewer.
There you are. I got it.
Man, you're such a genius. So let's listen to this song coming in from Lake Dube.
Yeah.
When we return,
More
of your life story.
Thank you.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Well, 91.3 Capital FM Desert Island, this series, bigger and better on YouTube and gets you to the comfort of the palm of your hands, depending on what gadget you're holding and watching us on. On the program today, Dr. Architect Kenneth Ssemwogerere, a man that thinks having knowledge is just not enough. It's important to share it. If for nothing else, make better the generation that comes after you. Hence, his SASA Innovation Center. So, you hit the university, you ace your examinations, but you get there on a high. Your alma mater hadn't sent anyone for the course of architecture in 3 years.
Yes.
And with prayer and hard work, there you were.
Yes.
Hit it up, read so hard. But come on, you're a young man growing up.
Yeah.
I'm always very much interested in how you got your mind tricked away from the hard things that you are doing at the university.
You know, I'll tell you that because I was very focused, you know, of course that helped me a lot. But besides that, I had friends who were almost, the same thinking with me, mm-hmm. you know. So that helped me a lot, even when you're trying to do things outside, you know, particularly the Christian Union, for some reason or the other, at that time had a lot of programs, prayer meetings, retreats, you know. So those ones are cool off a little bit, you know, you can play, you know, the so-called Nabinonya.
Yes. Somewhere close Kisubi, yes.
Yes, Nabinonya, then you go to Focus, and you go to Scripture Union, you know. So those ones will help us cool off. But again, in the context, like I told you, our norm was to do things in a Christian way.
Yes.
You know, there was nothing like, you just know this is off. Remember, I had come with some guys from Chibuli, and we are strong Christians. God has given us our courses, uh-huh. you know. So we tried our best to try and make sure that we keep it at that level.
Mm.
We weren't easily swigged by this or the other. So there you are. That's how we kept it running, you know.
That's very interesting.
Yeah.
And so now, you get into the architecture course. What exactly was intriguing for you? What did you want to do? Design the next generation of buildings? Design the next kind of skyscrapers? Or you simply were doing it for the prestige of a difficult course that you were able to manage?
Yeah, I really say difficult course. I'll tell you what happened. One time I had gone to I think it was Mitchell Hall, mm-hmm. and we are still freshers, and we don't know who's who, try to know each other. And then this guy tries to guess my course. Mm-hmm. You know, then he says, no, you're doing Bachelor of Science? Say, no, you're doing Bachelor of Economics? Then when I told him you're doing architecture, he almost said, go away from me.
I can't.
So it was
imagine.
That prestigious at that time, because there was no private sponsorship. Everybody had to come via the government selection. Very competitive. So we go to architecture, and I want to just use this chance to tell the young people, architecture is very interesting. You get there, it's not mathematics, it's not fine art, it's not literature. It's a mix. The big one is creativity.
Which I am sure was one of the things
forgotten.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because of the school system, creativity wasn't part of us. You do this, you do it. Wake up. Go for prep. Yeah, so that's the biggest challenge. That's why you don't hear a lot of first-class degrees in architecture. Because the first 2 years, you're finding your bearing.
And before you know it, you're halfway your course.
Yes, exactly. That's why it's a very difficult course. And as a lecturer, I know that, and I sometimes play parent. When a kid is breaking down, you just forget about being the tough lecturer, and you just try and bring them to, yeah, it's okay, you pull it off.
But I'm also sure that you had your, you know, dream projects and things that you wanted to design as a young man growing up with ambition and, you know, a lot of fire beneath your belly.
Mm.
Something that you'd want to leave the Ssemwogerere touch.
Mm.
Maybe a huge, obnoxious skyscraper gracing the skylines of Kampala. What?
Yeah. I had those ideas and that desire, but it wasn't that too much. What was critical for me was the mere fact that I'm going to put up a facility and to live beyond my life.
Mm-hmm.
That enough was good. And God has given me the chance to have things that I've designed on paper, and I see them become reality, and I'm very excited.
Wow. For example?
Yeah. For example, I designed the Senana Mall above KPC.
Oh.
Yes. You'll observe that it's the columns are not parallel to Buganda Road, neither are they parallel to Chagwe. They are parallel to the roundabout.
Why did you do that?
People pull you through like that. You walk through this grand 8-meter span. The client didn't finish the project. It's still maybe like 85% complete now.
Oh, really?
You know, but it's being used because of the financial and commercial bits. Mm-hmm. Eh? But you see, I had some water flowing over those two sides of the lift, you know, with the panoramic lifts when you walk in. Eh? And then the front part was a big one. Those front edges, you see, in the UK, that's where they feed birds and people use parties. That's why I left that space between the roundabout and the main entrance. It's all open. You can dance. People do some young people do some dancing.
You
there.
Can just do a flash move.
Yeah, and when you're there, you can see people on Kampala Road. You know, I'm here, come over here, you know. So I feel nice that my sketches, when I look at them and I see the building, so wow,
that's very interesting.
Yes, that's very satisfying.
But of course, I also know that you architects charge an arm and a leg. Sometimes we have to pay our entire inheritance to afford a simple sketch. So why are you that terrible?
No. I think the point is, you know, I usually tell people that if you use an architect, I've just done some work for a businessman. If you know when you're coming from Ntinda, you go to Nakawa, mm-hmm. there's a church opposite, there's Ntinda complex.
Yes.
The building that has an atrium in the middle with a staircase in the middle. Mm-hmm. And I tell you, the way I designed it, inside and outside, almost the same, because the light is coming in. The glass light at the top can be cleaned, you know. So the client has almost 90% full. And the other day I went, I was joking with him, I said, no, it was your wisdom, you know. And that's what makes our course. Well, that's what makes our profession. That you bring the value that will cause tenants to come and stay. You know, that will, you know, the corridors, the light effect, the sound, the views. You know, so the guy is growing. He's built another block down there. And it's all a complex. That makes sense, you know.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's very interesting.
That's satisfying.
So for you, it's the satisfaction of from scrapbook to brick and mortar.
Yes. That's it.
The in-between.
That's it.
Also takes your time because you've got to come and supervise and see whether the actual civil builders are doing what you envisage to do.
Yes.
What about when it comes to the perks that come with that? Do you sometimes think that you are paid handsomely for the incredible job that you do? That's important for someone who is about to pursue that course and is at crossroads.
Yeah, I think I've got some good clients who have paid me good money.
I won't ask what good is or what bad is, but certainly when you say good money and you're smiling, where some of us smile to the bank, you go laughing to the bank.
The point is, Simon, you would see that the client, appreciated your input, you know? And when you talked about the figures, you would feel that, yes. But most of the clients think about mortar and 10 tons of cement, 100 kilograms of steel.
Before blueprint and all that.
Yes. And for me, I've supervised a couple of projects, which I'll let you know now. I used to work with Ssentoogo, and I think I should take the chance to thank him so much. He's still alive.
Architect. Ssentoogo. He's the grandfather of all architects.
Yes, he's super. He was great. He gave me a chance.
How did you get up to work with him?
Yeah, when I finished university.
Mm-hmm. He came picking the best
students? No. I went and knocked at his door, mm-hmm. and in 2000, he gave me a job. And then, of course, I went and did my master's and came back 2004. Remember, I finished 1999. Mm-hmm. 2001, I went for my master's in Russia, and then I finished 2004, and I came back to join him. Lo and behold, I remember the date exactly, 2nd of August, 2004. I reported for work, and what did he tell me? Today, they're signing the contract for the new state house at Entebbe, and you're going to be the resident architect.
Wow.
So I looked after that building from scratch.
So fresh from a master's course in the Republic of Russia, right supervising the biggest masterpiece of a residential house in Uganda, state house in Entebbe.
Yes.
So any malpositionings, any ear-fitting?
It wasn't that we designed. The supervising architect had to make sure things are done properly because the contractor was Chinese, as people should know. Mm-hmm. And then at that time, it was more of a, you had to be there almost 24.
But who designed it initially? It looks more like the original state house as lived in by Sir Andrew Cohen.
Yeah.
And
I think we had another arm of Symbion, as another architecture firm, Symbion, whom we worked with in the design bit. Remember, I come in when you're going to hit ground and start construction.
Exactly.
So I looked through the construction. That was the big one. And some of the moments I thank God for is touring His Excellency, and that's like, okay.
Or taking him around.
Yes.
How do you feel? I mean, a young man in your 30s,
Simon,
and then His Excellency the President is looking at the house in which he intends to live.
It takes you about 10 minutes to settle down, you know. From the moment he says, you know, how are you?
From the moment
you can't believe yourself. You're not sure that you are there, or you don't feel yourself.
Your stomach is on the floor.
But thank God I pulled it off, because I told myself, nobody knows this project like I do. Okay, so His Excellency should listen. There you are.
But then he also asks questions.
Yes.
Some questions are a bit hard to...
I have a photograph where he's putting his eyes up and says, what is a skirting? I was telling him about, you know, then I would answer confidently, Your Excellency, you know. Then I finish, I hand over to Minister Nasasi, and you know.
Yes, skirting. So as a layman, I know what a skirt means. Yes. I'm talking about layman. Yeah. Could have been laywoman, but layman. So asking about a skirting.
Yeah. 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 So Architect Ssentoogo gave me a big chance. He let me be, you know, and I keep on checking on him because I love him, because he was there for me. And I'm being there for many, many young people.
So, but then you were able to lecture at the university, yeah. work for Ssentoogo, yeah. do your master's, yeah. and in fact go back and the pursue PhD. A PhD,
yeah.
which you got at a very tender age, before the age of 40.
Yes.
Must have been a heavy
50. The point was that when I came out in 2004, after finishing State House in 2007, I had, however, begun my PhD part-time in 2005.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd fly to Russia, do some paper presentations, you know. Then 2008, I went there full-time until mid-2009 when I graduated. It's a four-year course, but the first 3 years were part-time. That helped me a lot to juggle the whole thing. You know, and for me, what was very critical is that when I got to Russia, the Russians had it. They had stuff. Things were being explained, the things that we are failing to do here, safety. The guys were beginning discussing 1975.
Wow.
So that hooked me and said, I must stay here. I must do the PhD.
Language barrier, though. You speak a bit of Russian?
I do.
Ah, so part of what you had to do was learn the language.
Yes, and defend your thesis in Russian.
Hey?
Yes. 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 Because all the books were in Russian. You had to learn it. It was very devastating for you to read a paragraph for an hour because you had to correspond the... Initially, when you're learning the technical language, it was tough.
So you spent a whole year learning a language, yes. or even more than just a year?
A whole year.
Who paid for this?
The master's was government, and thank you, government of Uganda, but the PhD was myself. But then I had made some money, and so I paid for it.
You paid some from State House.
Yes. Now, recently, we have just supervised Acacia Mall. So we ticked up with one architect, Bowman. Bowman's architect who designed Westgate, the Hub Junction in Nairobi.
Mm-hmm.
So he designed Acacia Mall, but it wasn't registered here. So we did an association and I supervised Acacia Mall. And now we are supervising architects for Arena Mall.
The one in Zambia that will have the new
It's going to be state of art. Huh?
I can only wait. We can only judge you by the works of your hands. And that's very important that your mistakes are there for us to see. And the beauty of what you are is out there to marvel at us.
Yes.
That's it. Your next song.
I think my next song will be a hymn.
Another hymn.
Yes, a hymn from the Anglican Church. And this hymn, I don't know many people have listened to it. It says in Luganda that Yesu yonabi mani, in translated that Jesus knows it all. In those moments when you are very low, please be assured that God is not somewhere dead or sleeping. He is seeing it all. You know, people get threatened, like the church has been demolished, hell has broken loose. No. God sees these things and is still in charge.
That's a stuff of deep divinity for which I don't think I'm qualified to make a comment, except, of course, to honor your request Amen. And play that song Amen. Right away.
Thank you very much.
And, of course, and also acknowledge the fact that, indeed, God knows everything about our lives.
Yes.
I didn't know. 2 weeks ago, I would be sitting here with
exactly.
you.
Exactly, and thank you. Thank you for coming to Busika.
We'll be right back. It's Desert Island Discs.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.
Yesu byonna abimanyi jinsa nyusa antwana yekamukubo seta.
Welcome back. It's Desert Island Discs, and on the program we have an incredible gentleman. He designed buildings. He loves the sight of his sketches turning into the huge architectural marvels that we love to look at. He was a supervising architect for the State House, the house in which the President of the Republic lives. But that's not just about it. He's supervised the construction of huge malls whose spaces we all love. He is simply amazing. But also more amazing is what he's planning to do for especially young creatives that for the most part never amount to anything because they are never given the opportunity to raise up and practically create. So, Dr.
Yes.
Ssemwogerere,
yes.
you're making it all seem too serious, too formal, too straitjacket, too, you know, read hard, pass examinations, pray hard, do all sorts of things. But come on, you must have had a moment of play. But also, and most importantly, you now have a family. At what point did you meet the lady with whom you have children?
Yes. Jessica.
Through a scripture union arrangement?
Yesterday we actually made, I think that was yesterday, it was last. This week we made 18 years in marriage.
18?
Yes.
So if your marriage was an individual, they would now be adult enough
exactly.
to
My
indulge
daughter. Yes.
in many other things.
Yes.
So you have a child that's 18 already?
Yes, she's 17.
17.
And her results for IGSCE came out today.
Wow. You want to share? What
look like? She's performed very well.
Oh, she didn't want to just give you...
She's
permission.
I need to give her some gifts. Anyway, I met Jessica in about 1998, you know, when I was at fifth year level architecture. She's a nurse by profession.
Wow.
Yeah. And we met at a retreat, you know, a Christian retreat. And
Christian Union retreat.
Yes.
And trust you, nurses, I think, with a starched skirt with nice boots and a starched belt
Simon,
to go with.
That girl.
Describing what you saw? Anyway, we haven't discussed this, remember?
She's really a composed lady, and I thank her that she's been there for me. When I went to study, she kept here with the kids. At least we had Divine by that time.
Oh.
So we have four kids. We have Divine, the first girl. We have Destiny. We have Desire and Delight.
So you have them all in the 4Ds.
Yes.
While everyone is struggling for 3D, you have your 4D.
And my wife has been naming them all. I used to give the surnames, and she has a billion names, you know. So that's what we do. We live in Lusanja, and yeah, we are happy. And of course, Musika is taking a toll on us, but yeah, there you are.
You have got to build. I mean, yes. You are the man of the house, and together with your wife, you have to build this and make it work. But...
Yes.
I'm a little bit naughty in wanting to know how a scripture union retreat meant to strengthen your divinity and sanctity could lead to you catching the eye of a pretty nurse in the congregation.
I think it's because she was a singer, you know, so she did a song.
She belted away the lyrics and you said, my God.
Yeah, the Holy Ghost. Anyway, I don't understand that. But that's how it happened. And
I can see a bit of a sparkle in your eyes, Dr. Ssemwogerere, and a bit of a boyish shyness.
There you are.
I'm sorry if I've made you uncomfortable, but I know when it's talking matters of the heart, we get a bit jittery.
Yeah. God made us like that. Yeah.
I know.
Yeah.
And from then you have been, you know, living, like they say, proverbially, happy ever after.
Marriage has challenges, but you need to be stable enough and to appreciate who you are. And I appreciate your colleague. Yeah.
Especially for people like you who have got to run out of your homes to study.
Yes.
And she has got to stay long hours being a nurse.
Yes.
And yet you have children to raise.
Yes.
That can be
You understand
a combustive
it, Simon.
Mix.
You are perfectly put it. Yeah. Perfectly put it. Yeah. But God has been gracious. And one thing I want to tell even the married people, you came together for a purpose. So she has to, but I read the president's book, Mustard Seed, and read Madame, the First Lady's book as well. And when you hear the story, how the guy made up his mind to say, these elections have not been fair,
I'm out.
Off I go. You know, and then Janet had to run with the kids from here to Nairobi to Sweden, and, you know, then years without listening to what is happening to the guy. Is he there? But he was pursuing a particular goal. And thank God she got the news. Oh, the guy has taken over. You know, the rebels have...
So and, the government.
And now they are government. You know, she comes back and they're living a good life. So let's pay the price. Let's be together, try and pursue our goals, you know.
But talk about pursuing your goals. We are here in a yet to be completed piece of infrastructure. This SASA innovative. There's barely anything. It's just an empty floor with you. Yes. And you've sunk in so much and you continue to sink in so much. Yes. You, I mean, in the preps for this program, you were telling me how you've decided that from the proceeds of your private consultancy, every profit comes in here.
Yes.
What if it doesn't work? I'm sorry if I'm acting so pessimistic, but just because I want to know whether you'll commit suicide so we know where to start in our intervention.
Simon, the thing is, this thing, there is no option of doesn't work. And they'll tell you why.
I love that. Go get it.
Seriously. Because you see, Africa, we have been sleeping on the job. And I've been struggling to tell people, this is not a vocational training institute. Mm-hmm. No. And I'll explain to you why. Our friends, the funding agents, have been very, very clear that they're funding Skilling Uganda, vocational training, technical colleges. That is second tier. And I'll explain to you. You have a carpenter and you have a furniture designer. A carpenter cannot design furniture.
He makes what has been designed.
You have an architect, you have a contractor.
A builder.
Yes.
I thought it was one and the same guy, because me, I called the carpenter, So that guy takes all the money and doesn't give me anything because I choose the design. Yeah. Sometimes I design it.
Exactly. And then you remember that because of that, even you go to steel welding, they are designed, that's why the windows are the same. Because by virtue of their training of the 2 years of technical college, there is no way
they can create.
Exactly.
So they just assemble.
Exactly. But they've done a good job. They have sustained us. But now it's time. Africa slept on the job long enough. Let's trade our own brand of designers and then hook up with our colleagues who have been in the field. There's the tailor and there's the fashion designer.
They normally are one and the same. My sister does the fashion designing, and then you see on the sewing machine.
And then you make a... No, you look at the suits, you know? And this I got through a long, about 3 years of research. And that's what took me to Australia, that's what took me to Canada. And when I went there and I saw the caliber of designs, these industrial design graduates are coming up with, I was beaten. The drones. They're doing drones, they're doing... health equipment. They're doing the next generation of a car. I was in Hong Kong University, South Korea, and the young guy is designing the next light. I bet the Kia car now is giving a hard time to Toyota, but it's very recent, isn't it? Why? Because of design. And this is that's why I'm telling you in my preamble that I have to approach other people. This is not about me anymore. It's no longer about me anymore. You're doing Kapeka, you're doing Namanvi, you're doing Bali Industrial Park. What are you going to produce if you don't design?
If you don't design it from first principle,
exactly,
in such place.
What are you going to design? Wow. What are you going to produce? You know, and Africa, the balance of payment deficiency, you know, the president has done a good job. Value addition, you hear him saying value addition. You hear him saying power, roads. The poor guy has struggled to give us power. But it's going to be redundant if you don't give high value products.
But someone will also argue that why should I bother myself to go into design of car lights, for example, or gear levers, when Mercedes already employs someone to do that, and I can only simply copy and paste.
And paste, you know? And we could do that, Simon. But the point I'm bringing up is, now listen to me carefully. We have so many young people. Okay? And these young people are brilliant with ideas. Mm-hmm. You get my point?
So they are better designers than those that are designing new Mercedes lights.
Exactly. Look at your bow tie. Look at you. You're very smart. But somebody can sketch you up, isn't it? He can bring a bow tie with another form. How about that? And then they'll buy it.
It won't be a bow tie.
If you have time, I'll give you a story about export-led industrialization for South Korea. And for me, I'm very passionate about that. Hopefully, one day I'll get a chance to lead. And if I get a chance to lead, I know what to do. Because the issue of
to lead, you have the ambition of being president?
No, maybe.
I love that. And who knows?
But you have to prove yourself. And that's what I'm doing here in Busika. People should come here and marvel and say, can a single individual have an idea, pursue it? I told you about the equipment from Australia.
If he can do this,
yes,
then maybe he has a lot in store if he's given the plateau of leadership.
Yeah, and we're going for votes. And I want to tell you, by the time I stand that I'm going to lead, people will be down squarely because they will see I'll be talking facts, you know? Enough of talking stories and taking us for a ride, drop us there, leave us there. Forget it. Now, the parliament is 500 people. My first point of call, parliament must fall. The numbers must go down like yesterday.
Now, Ssemwogerere, you're getting yourself in a bit of trouble. And I don't take responsibility for what happens to you now. We have an innovation center to build and a family to raise. But that said, what gets you angry? You seem to be a very happy-go-lucky guy, always smiling and all that.
Yeah.
But there must be something that gets you a bit angry. Is it the state of our politics as it is today?
No.
Because I can see you are heading there.
People who know what to do, and they don't do it. Just that. You tell me you're going to come and see me at this time, and you don't show up, you don't call, you know? And you know, people who think that Europe is much better, that this skin has a problem. Doesn't have. Sorry. We just have to wake up. You tell me, well, that's it. That makes me angry if people know what to do and they don't do. And yet they have the capacity.
Well, what gives you a hearty laugh? Now let's look at the brighter side.
What makes me happy is to be around people who are laughing and having fun and cracking jokes. I don't usually go bad if you crack a joke on me. And you know, even my students, when I'm teaching, people are passing by the corridors, sometimes the students blast into big laughs. Is this a class or some?
Do you have a particular nickname that your students have bestowed to you that you may be aware of?
Simon, I don't know. They could tell me, but I'll tell you, one of the students wrote to me thanking me for giving him a retake. Made them a better person, you know?
Were they being honest?
Well, they graduated already. They graduated.
So they wrote to you after the graduation. That letter would have sounded different if it was before the graduation.
Yes. I'll be fearing always going to do something bad to me, you know?
Oh, he has put in some biological weapon in there. I normally ask people this question. Yes. We have a beautiful country with incredible cuisine. What's your favorite dish?
My favorite dish is, interestingly, rice and chicken.
Man, you're a typical Chebando, Buganda Road kid, you know. You're not the kid that grew up on matoke and some bit
no,
of, you know.
It's rice and chicken. You
know? Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. And how do you wash it down?
With Pepsi. I have a problem there. I'm working on it, but I don't know how.
You are a bit addicted to cola products. There you are. So,
yeah.
But you should try something a little bit more harder than that. Man, you're a hard man today. Why did you just take all these little soft drinks, as they say?
I'll pray about that.
You pray about that. Please, and if the prayer comes in the sense that I should join you in the soft drinks, we have to do a retake a little bit.
Simon, I like
so
this.
So where do we see you? We can see the vision,
yes.
But let's close our eyes and imagine you in 10 years, 20 years. Where do we see you?
Yeah.
Where do we see you?
I think I'll be.
Innovations. Well, you may be president of the republic that we put on the side, okay? How next?
I think I'll be a person who's satisfied. I look forward to coming here and seeing former craftsmen copying tables, but now are designing their own tables. People who are came here, they do nothing. And one group I would target is the S6 leavers. Simon, people don't know what people go through when you miss your loved course.
You're asking me.
Yes.
You're telling me.
Hey, you're telling me. Okay. So I look forward to seeing a group of young people here designing. And then we have a brand called Made in Uganda.
Wow.
Yes.
Lovely.
And everything made in Uganda. And, you know, people are proud of it, you know, because we design it from first principles.
There's something that you... drivers of the innovation and youth employment spirit in this country don't seem to talk about. You talk about unemployment, but have you bothered to look at the unemployability of many young people? Something not out of the lack of skill,
I hear
something born from the absence of a good attitude.
I hear you. And Simon.
And the desire for we young people to make it big so quick, therefore going in to cut corners in life and wanting to drive a Mercedes on your second week on the job.
and I think You're spot on, Simon. And what I'm going to do here, I do have a board above me, my board of directors. But one thing we've made up our minds on, we shall also tackle the soft skills.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. The mindset is very critical. You don't just tell off people, you know. You have to know that things come from hard work. And you know the reason that's happening? When we were growing up, people were rich. We knew where the money was coming from.
Mm-hmm. Even those who stole, you know, at the old Yabba.
Yes.
And it was
if
known.
You ever drove a Peugeot, you know he works on Uganda House. He has a pharmacy. But now, like you rightly said, the young guy...
You can't know where the guy works.
Yes.
They just say, Akora Mutawun.
Yes.
Buddy.
Church Tambula, you know. So we have a lot of work to do. And that's what I propose actually to leaders. With the whole mindset change. Because you see, like when you go to Europe or to London, and the train comes and it is full, you just skip away, another one is coming. The mind is telling you that, no, you know, relax, you know. But again, at the same time, it's hard work. It's hard work. And I hope we can pull it off, Simon, at some point.
Very final question on the program. As always, we say, beautiful country, endowed with all the wonderful physical features, flora and fauna therein. If you had to be marooned on a desert island, maybe for a walk, or a weekend, where would you choose to be in this country and why?
Hey, this country? Mm. Wow.
Here in Busika, Saturday.
I think I would be in Fort Portal.
Uh-huh.
Yes. That place is cool. It's
six nice. Out of 10 people that sit on that side of the conversation always talk about Fort Portal.
Are you sure? Mm. Yeah, it's beautiful. People should go there and see. And the Fort Portal, is it a city now?
Oh, yes, it is now.
I pledge to help them if they can come to me, you know. Uh-huh. They should do something. It is serious. They have everything to take, you know. Yeah, and I'll be glad, you know. And all the other cities, let's wake up. Let's do something good.
Especially, at least for nothing, a big monument that says something about the city. Yes, architect Dr. Kenneth Ssemwogerere. It's been a pleasure having you on the program,
Thank you. Having this conversation with you so much.
And learning about your life story. But also most inspiring is what you intend to do with the later part of your life story.
Thank you.
Without a doubt, I know you'll be back on that very seat to tell us the progress of your life story from today to the point at which we will meet.
I look forward. Yeah.
So the only way to say kwaheri to our listeners is by you dedicating them another song, which will be your last.
Wow.
Or is the dedication meant for Jessica?
First of all, just to say that even my siblings, I want to thank them so much. Yeah, Andrew, Ruth, Stephen, Sam, Brian, you know, David, Namakula. You know, there are many. But then the song I want to end with is what our guy, local guy, sang, Philly, Bongo Le Lutaya.
The best that ever lived.
Yeah, the issue of scent.
Money.
Scent, 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 you know. That money shouldn't take us out of our bodies. You know, that everybody's looking for money badly. Let's go back and meditate on that song.
That was in the 80s. If only he had lived way into the 2000s to see how money is making us go crazy, he would be singing another kind of
song. Well, thank you so much.
Let's enjoy the program. Yeah. Let's enjoy the show. Yeah. Let us enjoy the music, especially with your kind of music that takes us on the divinity part of it. Then it brings us down memory lane with Philip Bongoletaya concluding it. We've had a good time.
Thank you so much, Simon.
For you, our viewers and listeners and everyone in between that grace this program every single Sunday, you could have been doing anything else, but you choose to be on the program and listening keenly. We don't take that for granted. From wherever it is that you listen to us from, wherever it is that you're watching us from, it's Kwaheri for this edition. We'll be back same time, same place next week with yet another inspirational conversation from an incredible guest. God bless.
Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM. Desert Island Discs on 91.3 Capital FM.